My name is Tori Sparks, and I am from Chicago, then Nashville, and now Barcelona, Spain. And I moved to Barcelona about 4.5 years ago and have recently released an album called El Mar, which is my fifth album, a collaboration with a flamenco fusion band called Calamento. And I am extremely happy to be back in Germany. I've been here before as a solo artist and with the band, and it's always freezing, but really fun. It's a song called The Weeping Woman is La Llorona, and it's a terrible story. She drowned her children because the man she loved didn't want them, and then later her ghost goes by the river just weeping for her children. But there are many, many verses to this song, and we selected the ones that talk more just about painful relationships and love, because that's what I have been able to relate to. I haven't drowned anybody, but I definitely have had a bunch of really interesting breakups. So, but I love the song La Llorona because it is impossible to sing it half-heartedly. You're saying, even though I will die, I will always love you. You can't say that like... So it's a fun song to sing. It's very cathartic.
Yo soy como el chile verde, llorona, picante, pero sabroso. Yo soy como el chile verde, llorona, picante, pero sabroso.
La Llorona is a song from the new album, El Mar, and I thought, actually, that people would say, we prefer your older stuff from the other four albums, the blues, the folk, and the rock, but this new album is a combination of those elements and Spanish music, and it's gone very well, and I'm happy. And also, it's great because it seems like there are not very many Spanish speakers in the German audiences, so if I mess up the words, nobody says anything. It's fantastic.
La Llorona is a song from your new album, El Mar, and it's a collaboration with the flamenco trio Calamento. How did you get to know each other?
We happened to be on the same bill for a benefit concert together. And after they played an instrumental set, three songs, I went up to them and said, look, I need your phone number. And one of them says, he didn't say this, but one of them, I won't say who, said, I have a girlfriend. I said, no. I need your phone number for professional reasons. He swears he didn't, but that's what he said. So we ended up collaborating together, the percussion player and I, on rock and blues. And then he said, would you like to sing with my band sometime, just to try it? And I wanted to before, but I didn't want to ask because I thought I would be intruding on their project. So we tried a few rehearsals and it went really well. And we eventually ended up deciding to do an album together. And we also included a guitar player who is a wonderful, amazing, very versatile musician named El Rubio. And the five of us are now this El Mar project. And we thought nobody would like it, actually. But we've ended up in Rolling Stone in Spain. We've ended up all over the place. And I feel very grateful for that.
So Tori, you have studied the flamenco in Granada. How about you teach us something about the flamenco?
Flamenco traditionally is guitar and voice and palmas, which is hand clapping.
Okay, so something like...
Right?
I totally can't do it.
Well, especially singing, it's hard. There's a song called Everybody Knows that we do, and it's actually a Leonard Cohen song that we turned into a tango, which is in four, the right. So it's very hard to sing. You say, everybody knows that the dice are loaded. Everybody rolls with their fingers crossed. Everybody knows the war is over. Everybody knows that the good guy is lost. And so the thing is, that seems easy, but to play a flamenco rhythm, or in 12 is even harder, and to sing blues, they don't go together, typically. So it's a question of kind of rewiring your mind.
Yes, I can imagine. And then it's not only the new style of music, but you also come across new countries, new cultures all the time. I think you've been to 25 countries in the last 2 years. What have been one or two of the most unexpected experiences you have made?
Some of the most unexpected experiences that have happened have been just fleeting moments. For example, driving in California. I remember driving a 12-hour drive to the next gig and looking out the window, and there was this forest of cactus. These cactus, those big ones that are bigger than me. And on the side of a mountain, some hippie had taken the time to cut down a bunch of the cactus in the shape of a big heart on the side of the mountain. So just weird things like that that you would never see if you were not happening to travel up that coastline that day. Or someone will come up to you after a show and say, you know, thank you, I've had the worst day of my life and you just helped me. So it's that part is what pays you back for all the hours in the car and the times when you get lost.
So now, since you're traveling a lot, what would you like to put in your suitcase, even though you can't?
I would have to choose between three things, either a curling iron for my hair, my cat, or my boyfriend. One of those three. None of them fit. So those are the things I miss when I'm on the road.
Well, your cat would fit a little bit better.
Oh, I'd have to punch holes if the cat came with me. I don't know about that. She wouldn't be happy.
Actually, how's your cat while you're writing songs?
My cat gets this expression on her face like, she doesn't like get the guitar. I think she thinks I'm yelling at her.
Oh, okay, so there's a big misunderstanding.
Yeah, the blues makes her very upset, so.
Yes. And is she like sitting or lying on your sheet of paper while you're writing?
Oh, when I'm trying to write a song, my cat has a tendency to stretch out right on the paper and the pen and the guitar and anything to distract me from what I'm doing, because she's the center of the universe. She's a little tiny furry princess.
Of course, and now she owns your whole place anyway, because you are on the road, you're playing your new songs. Actually, what do you prefer? Playing in front of a big crowd or in a small venue?
When I'm touring, I run into all different kinds of live situations. Sometimes you play for 30,000 people in a big festival like Montreux in Switzerland or in Belshire in Asheville, North Carolina. And those are good opportunities for me professionally, because you get the chance to, more than anything else, just to say that you have played there. And that's a good thing for an independent artist. But the polar opposite is when you're in a city you've never been to before, you have no audience at all, you have no local support, and whoever organized the show maybe didn't promote it so well, and you play for two people. Probably the worst show I ever did was at like a sandwich place that was supposed to be a music club, but it was really just a sandwich place. And they had promoted the show as being on a different day. So I played for one homeless guy and the bartender. That was the best. But the homeless guy was really nice, so, you know, you just go with it. But I would have to say my favorite venues are in between, to be honest. Usually a few hundred people is the best equilibrium between a big crowd that's worth traveling 8 hours to play for and the ability to still connect with the audience in kind of an intimate and personal way, because I find that a lot of singer-songwriters start out playing in coffee shops, but I started out playing in bars. So I had to learn really early at 17, how do you get these people who are drinking beer and do not care to love you? So that's part of the show for me, is interacting with the audience and making it a personal experience, because if they just wanted to hear the music, they could buy a CD, you know. But if you have two people, well, it's harder to create a dynamic. And if you have 30,000, it's almost the same. So I think my favorite experiences have been somewhere in between.